Do you ever feel like somehow you miss the mark on relating to customers and employees? Is it a Gen Z thing or differences across multiple generations? Maybe it's you, not them. Today we explore trust and how it contributes to your success or failure. Guest Tanner Lyons, whose own troubled past could have hardened him into something other than the gifted leader he is today. He and I share our own awkward and uncomfortable journey as we sum up past dramas. How we went from behaviors of survival to finding new pathways to communicating. Now, with a new understanding, could this character trait be the key to unlocking a better you and build the tribe you were meant to lead? Let's find out. Get ready to level up your powder coater game. Welcome to Ross Coates Powder Coater Podcast. I'm your co-host, Kim Scott, where we interview influencers and talk about trending topics so you can grow your powder coating biz. Today's topic is going beyond company culture. We want to introduce some insights into developing your personal transformation and leadership to run a team of people or just a handful of people in your small shop. It's my pleasure to introduce Tanner Lyons, whom I met at Powder Coating Week and works for Demco Manufacturing, where they manufacture and powder coat and paint towing products and ag products. Tanner, welcome to the show.
Hey, it's nice to be here. Thank you.
Yeah. So as I said, we met on the last day of Powder Coating Week, and we were sitting next to Dave Flatten, who owns Inland Powder, very iconic and leadership, kind of a large personality in the custom coating world. I think he has over 100 employees out of California. So it's a fairly large shop. And so I thought, I'm going to sit next to this big bear guy because I know he's smart and he's going to have, and our table, you joined with your guys, and our table at the last day, you know, what they do is they ask a lot of futuristic questions or trends or future that you, you know, the future you see in powder coating. And you were raising your hand every time. But everything you said that day, Tanner, made total sense. And I'm thinking, what's up with this guy? He's got all the answers. So tell me more about, you know, Demco, how you got to start there. And then we'll get into why you had all the answers that day. So welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. I've been with Demco about 7 years. I started like everybody else started. I came in the door and they were like, well, we're going to put you here. And so I started in the towing division, and I was building like tongues for tow dollies, I think, at the time. And I was just like a temporary employee. And so I started there, and then I kind of worked my way into quality. And so it was kind of, hey, we think you'd be good at this. Why don't you try this? So they put me in quality, and I'm in quality to this day. And so I've been able to do a lot of really cool things for Demco. So
yeah, and Demco is no small company. In fact, let me pop them up on this stage here. You guys, I think you said you had over 400 or around 400 people. And where are you guys? What state is this?
So this is, we're located in Iowa in a little town called Boyden. And then we have a plant in Spencer also. And they manufacture a lot of our trailer components. So our big trailers, our side dumps and our head trailer, our head transports, things like that. Scrap trailers. So they manufacture, they're big in our trailer division. We manufacture anything from ag equipment, as you can see here, there's grain carts on tracks. Mm-hmm. And then from the grain carts to towing products, which are fifth wheel hitches, couplers. We sell a lot of easy latch couplers. That's a big seller for us. And We do like supplemental braking systems too, which those supplemental braking systems you put in your vehicle behind your RV, and they apply the brakes as you apply the brakes in your RV. So we do a lot of different things. We're pretty diverse.
Yeah. And now all these products powder coated or just some of them, are they painted and powder coated? How do you,
Yeah. So a lot of them are powder coated, like that trailer brake actuator you see, and then the trailer coupler, that's all powder coated. We do get things e-coated and anodized, and we have different things like electroplating that we do or that we have done. We don't do that in-house, but so most of the stuff that we do in-house in our powder coat and in our liquid booth.
Awesome. Awesome. And how many, so how many are in your, at the plant that you work at, do you think? I mean, I know you're, you know, you're just in one section.
300.
Quality. Oh, okay. And then the other plant has the rest of the 100 something people.
Yeah, correct.
Awesome. All right.
It's kind of hard to keep track. We're growing all the time. So it's just one of those things.
It seems like you're in a really nice area too. And I guess not to kind of get too deep with this topic, but just a quickie question I had about Demco is like, you know, you have to have like a certain population, right? To support a company, right? Like this size. So
yeah.
How does that work? I mean, has the population grown as Demco's grown? Are there other factories around? How does it work economically there for you guys?
That's tough because, yeah, we do have a lot of other factories located around us in and around our vicinity. So there are multiple. How do we do it? We employ a lot of families. So yeah. We have mothers and brothers and sisters and cousins and aunts and uncles. They all work for the company, generational people that work for the company. So in a community this small, basically anybody and everybody, you know, around, I mean, we have people, my next door neighbor works for Demco.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, it's just one of those things where it's the community. So the community supports it.
That's, doesn't anybody and everybody want that? I mean, to me, I guess if I wasn't an entrepreneur or did, you know, like wanted to, you know, it's everybody wants that. They want to be part of something bigger than themselves or part of a team or part of a group of people that are, have a mindset about them. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about today, right? Before we do, I love see the guy in the red shirt or the sweatshirt, and you can kind of see a little bit back here about something team. And I think this is a familiar. So when we talk about this book, you'll see this kind of like black and yellow striped thing on the book because, the gentleman we're going to talk about today, has written a book called Blue Collar Leadership and Teamwork, and it outlines character development traits, right? Or how to develop your character to create a workforce and an employee culture that is extremely supportive. I mean, anybody would want that. I mean, everybody that goes to work, even the top brass, the leadership, they all want this too, right? So it's kind of getting everybody all on the same page, right? So
it really is. The books, and I know you'll get into that a little bit, but you know, the books give traits. And so you look at those traits, and so it's like a unifying principle, right?
Yeah.
So you have a unifying principle, something that you can unify and get behind. And so everybody that chooses to is reading the same books. They're going through the same things. So we're all kind of thinking in the same pattern, I guess, is,
right.
is how you
kind of like a hive in a sense, but not like a cult. Obviously that would be way to the extreme of that. Yeah. Right. But, you know, for Ross and I, it's just us. Right. So, I would like to think that we would be in the same mindset. Sometimes it's not. And that's what makes the door so very important here.
Right. You just leave in the background, just doing the work. Absolutely. Yeah,
our company culture is this door right here that separates us. But, you know, not everybody has just two people working for themselves or work, you know, it's just a small shop. We did have an employee, but then when the fires happened, it just all, you know, got slow again and stuff. So it's a little disappointing, but, you know, our economy will bounce back at some point. It's just a matter of waiting it out. Right. So, but, you know, how did it all start happening? I mean, did it happen before you got there, or did it happen that you got this leadership thing going there, this program? How did it get introduced to the company, and did it happen before you got there or after you got there?
Yeah. So, I was introduced to it probably 5 years ago now. I was in quality. I was fresh into quality. And so they sent me to this thing called a Lean Consortium. I've never heard of it before in my entire life. I mean, I know what it is now and I know what Lean is now, but at the time I was like, oh yeah, I'll go there. You know, I get to get out of work for a little while and go and listen to some people. And so I ended up meeting Mac and Rhea Story there at the Lean Consortium. It's just the next town away. And a few other employees also came with, and they had the opportunity to do that. And then I ended up winning his books. And I know I told you that story a little bit before, but it was kind of like,
you didn't, you know, get they had the main prize, right?
Right. Well, yeah, they had the laptop at the end, and I was like, man, I wish I would have got that laptop, right? But I won his books instead, and I was like, awesome books. And so I brought them home, and I brought them home, and I kind of started thumbing through them a little bit, and you know, they really kind of spoke to me.
Cool.
You know, the stuff that he was saying in his books, it spoke to me, because I've never worked in manufacturing before, not in my whole life. You know, I was in sales before, and I worked in the natural gas industry, and, you know, just different things in my past. And so I never worked in manufacturing before. So when I started to read his books, it was kind of like, well, this makes a lot of sense, you know, and it kind of outlines, you know, how to thrive in an environment when there's so many different people, or even when there's just a few people, and how can you stand out, not to say, look at me, but how can you stand out with your work ethic and with who you are? And it kind of details that a little bit. So,
right. Cause most people just want to kind of get to that leadership position, so they're ready to climb over and step on and stomp on as many people as they possibly can. It can be that way sometimes, whereas this
is a possibility,
right? You know, you know, their focus is not, it's not the book of the, you know, the focus of the book is not necessarily climbing to the scaling to the top and beating everybody out, but more of like, it's about your character that makes you a true leader. And I certainly can get behind that. That's what we all, I think we all aspire to be, you know, cause that.
Yeah. And we can talk about that a little bit, but to kind of finish what your question was is, so, I was on a trip to Charlotte, I believe, doing a supplier evaluation for the company at the time. And I was in Charlotte. I knew that they had invited Mac and Rhea, and I knew it was serious because I met them before. So I was like, this is going to be pretty awesome. But I was in Charlotte. We ended up flying back, me and Naveen. He's a real good guy. It works for us. And so we went out, we did the supplier evaluation. We flew back. And the very next day is when I found out that they shut the company down for this. So what they ended up doing is they ended up shutting the company down, and whatever profits they would have made for the day, which it was a smart idea. To shut it down and to bring everybody together, but they shut it down. They rented an event center. They invited Mac and Rhea in to speak, talked extensively about the book and why he was there and what they wanted for culture and, you know, what the goal was. And they kind of told some stories, and they do that a lot. They tell stories to show how you can apply these certain concepts. Right. And so they did that, and they served us all food, and they did some other things for us, which were very nice too. But, you know, like I said, they shut it down for them to come in and to say, hey, this is the way we want to move. This is where we want to go. We've made some steps to get here, but this is what we feel like is going to take us over the top. So we had that, and that's kind of how the ownership introduced it to the company.
Okay.
So,
yeah. Well, that's a brave you know, like you said, it's a brave move in any direction to shut a company down to make it so vitally important to train and, you know, change mindsets with hundreds of people. So that's a story in and of itself, right? But what aspects or what specific changes or improvements have you noticed in your leadership now that you've kind of been with this, these books, and there are other training opportunities there too, right? You have access to a whole app of videos and stuff like that with this program that the company allows or gives access to every employee with. But, you know, so what have you noticed in your own leadership abilities, or how is it that you feel like when you are implementing these principles from the book?
Well, when we talk about principles, and so I was going to read a chapter, it's a very short chapter, so bear with me. But all the chapters are kind of laid out this way. So they're really easy to learn. They're very poignant. They get to the point and they don't pull any punches. So I'll just go ahead and start with the chapter. Mm-hmm.
The book, and then give us an example. Give us an example after the chapter of how you, if you can.
Oh, I can. So trait two, and we'll just start with trait two. It says, be trustworthy. Your character will either launch you or limit you. What you really are will speak so loudly that what you claim you are will not be heard. And then it goes on. With trust, we have much influence. Without trust, we have little influence. With trust, team morale is high. Without trust, team morale is low. With trust, we work together. Without trust, we work separately. With trust, the mission is likely to be accomplished. Without trust, the mission is likely to be compromised. When it comes to high-performing blue-collar teams, there's one thing I know for certain. Trust is the one thing that impacts everything. You can't make someone trust you. You can't make someone trust me. It simply isn't possible. What is possible? Constantly making choices that make us trustworthy people. Ultimately, you must choose to be trustworthy. I must choose to be trustworthy. Trust is the foundation upon which high-impact teams thrive. Each player, regardless of their position, title, or rank, is responsible for intentionally helping the team build a strong foundation of trust. The principles you discover on these pages, if applied, will help anyone at any level become a high-impact team player. My blue-collar career, and this is Mac talking about himself, obviously, but he says, my blue-collar career started on the front lines of a manufacturing plant in 1988. Operating a large, hot, dirty, and extremely oily vertical broach. Funny thing was, is when I started operating a vertical broach. That's just a coincidence. Then I began to be promoted into various support roles where I continued to work with those on the front lines. Once again, promoted into a support role myself. For the first 10 years, I had basically been an individual contributor on a big team. To succeed, all I had to do was meet or exceed my production goals while working by myself on my machine. I wasn't part of an official team or a committee, but trust for me was about getting individual results. I simply had to perform and produce. When I began to be promoted, everything changed. In the support roles, I had to work with and through others. I also started to be assigned to various types of teams. No longer was my success based primarily on my knowledge, skill, and abilities. To be effective, I had to establish trust while working with others, which meant I had to be seen as trustworthy, and others had to establish trust with me. Trust is a two-way street. At that point in my career, my success began to be based on my ability to build relationships. My success started with me, but it was no longer about me. As the years progressed, I began accepting opportunities to lead teams. Not only did I have to continue building trust, but I had to start helping others learn to build trust. And between 2005 and 2012, I logged over 11,000 hours in blue collar industries, leading leaders and their cross-functional teams through process improvement, organizational change, and cultural transformation. As a result, I learned many lessons from many people. I've written this book to help you become more valuable and successful as you think deeply about the choices that you will make, well, that will make you trustworthy, will make you a trustworthy high impact team player. And then it goes on for a little bit, and I'll just kind of skip down here. And it says, trust is based on two things. One, a person's character, who they are. Two, a person's competency, what they know. Numerous studies have revealed our character is responsible for 87 to 90% of our ability to build trust. And our competency is responsible for only 10 to 13%. All of my books focus on character development. When it comes to trust, character counts. So be trustworthy is the most important trait. However, this one trait is based upon many other traits. In each of the following chapters, I'll share a trait that will help you be trustworthy. There are seemingly endless character traits that will make you a trustworthy person. While leading thousands of blue-collar team members, I've validated these 30 key traits many times. Learn and embrace them, and you will be trustworthy. And then there's a quote from Michael Josephson that says, I judge myself by my best intentions, but others judge me by my worst acts. And when you talk, it's powerful stuff when you think about it, because you talk about being trustworthy. The one thing, everybody's like, well, I'm a trustworthy person. But what he's saying here is do your actions align with what you say you are?
Right.
So if you're, are you authentic? Are you an authentic mm-hmm. person? Because none of us are perfect. We're all going to have things about us that we don't like. And so we take and we work on those things. And so we're not asking for perfection. And he's not asking for perfection. He's saying, if you find things in this book that you can work on, this is going to help you. And this will, right. And he gives examples and he shows. And so for me, trust, right? So we have to develop trust on a daily basis. We develop trust with our families, with our friends. We develop trust with our coworkers, and we develop trust with our manufacturers and our distributors. And so without trust, you can't get business done. So if I was on a Zoom call earlier today and we were talking about some issues, but if what I'm saying isn't trustworthy and it's not authentic, the work's not going to get done. And it's not just about the work. It's about people and reaching out and being authentic and being trustworthy and being humble and all of these different traits that make you who you are. It's like you don't have to tell people who you are. You show people who you are. And that's what it's about. Personal responsibility, personal stuff.
And, you know, I think what spoke to me was kind of halfway through that chapter. It was about choice, right? You choose to be trustworthy. It's an act you do every day. And I don't know, I guess I am just, you know, I'm kind of naturally that way. Although we're going to get into some stuff later on personal wise about trust, and stuff. And I'm so glad that you read this because it really is the core. I mean, it's great to talk about the success that Demco's had with this system and everything like that and how you, satisfy or solve problems or get in there and get your hands dirty to get the project done or whatever. But in the end, we're talking about personal transformation on this podcast today that can affect everything around you, right? From your family to your work, your employees and stuff like that. And I don't know, that word just spoke to me, choice. You choose to be trustworthy. And I think that's hard. Sometimes people don't want to share their personal trauma at home or what's going on with the wife or the kids or whatever. And it can, I think people tend to feel like they have to not be authentic because it's too complicated to explain the truth behind, the curtain or the theater at home, right? Or what's going on with them personally, right? So, but before, let's continue on this journey. So Is there anything you wanted to add to that chapter read that you wanted, any point you wanted to make? That was mine. Choice was a key word for me.
Yeah. And, you know, you talk about that word choice, right? And so you choose to be trustworthy. Well, you choose everything in your life. You choose mm-hmm. who you are, who you're going to be. You choose your actions. You're only in control of three things: your thoughts, your feelings, and your actions. And those are the only three things in life that we say that we can control. So when it talks about it, and we can get into that a little bit here in a little bit, but it's kind of like, I used to have this mentality of like, if only they would, or if only this person would do this, or mm-hmm. if this person would, I would be able to. And it's kind of like, this is a way to take a look at, not that you are the problem, but it's a way to take a look at yourself and to say, where can I get better? Where am I lacking? Why do I feel frustrated? Why do I feel a certain way? And so digging into that and then trying to live those principles. And I say trying to live those principles because nobody jumps into this and is perfect at it right away. It's kind of like, I've read this book. It's pretty weathered. This is my signed copy, but I've read that book probably 10 times. Mm-hmm. You know, and you get something a little bit different from it every single time you read it. Yeah. So you're a little further along and a little further along, and you read more books and you read more books, and then you come back to it and you're applying all the principles, and then you find something else in it.
Yeah.
And you're like, ah, oh, I didn't see it that way before.
Yeah. So let's get into that. So to reiterate the question, what have you noticed in your own leadership abilities at work? You know, can you give us an example of that? You know, maybe a recent one or something that just stands out in your mind.
Yeah. So being trustworthy. So we talk about that, and you go from just doing your job to getting asked a lot of questions. And so
Because you're the quality control guy. Why are you asking me? You know, like, right. I remember you talking about that.
Yeah. A little bit, because you don't know how much you're changing until you see it from other people's eyes. Mm. And so you think to yourself sometimes, have I really, how much have I actually changed? How well is this working for me? And when I mean working, I don't mean that I'm being promoted all the time or anything like that. What I mean is how well is it working? And you can tell because of the people that put their trust in you. And so, and that can be difficult at times. Nobody ever said it was going to be easy, but it's like that you start getting asked a lot of questions. Like, how do I do this? Or what do you think about that? Or what should I do in this situation? And so I get that quite a bit. Non-business related, we could be at work and somebody would come to me and say, how would I handle this situation? And you're like, wow, why are they asking me? But yeah, so how do I apply it? I mean, it gets applied every day. It's hard to put it into words how, when you get into it and you're reading all of these books and you're taking in all this information, it's like in the book, it talks about being the first. And so how do you develop and build trust, right? And mm-hmm. And how do you do that with people? And so that can be a major roadblock for a lot of people. It's like, well, how do I build this trust? This person doesn't trust me, or I have no influence. And we can't gain influence with everybody. And he talks about influence in the book. And influence is leadership. If you're an influential person, you're a leader, whether you choose to be or not, you are.
Right.
And so if you have a podcast, right? And you're the host of the podcast. Well, you're an influential person. You have influence on people. So the words that you say, they matter.
Yeah.
And so you have to be careful because when people ask things, you want to give the best answer, but you don't always. Sometimes you come back and you have more conversations with people, but building and developing trust is like raising your hand saying, you know what? I'll help. I'll do that. I won't drop the ball, even though there are times when you do drop the ball. you try to come back and you try to make sure that you pick it back up and you say, listen, this is important to me. You are important. And we have a conversation, or I try to help you with your issue.
Yeah.
So that's just a daily thing. I mean, it happens to me every single day. And we get people that come into the lab every day and, hey, can I get your help with this? And
right.
Of course, our response is yes, because we help. That's what we do.
Right. Yeah. You get in there and it doesn't matter what, you're just out there to solve the problem, you know, to keep the line going or get the job out the door or whatever. It's just getting in there and working truly as a team, I guess, you know, because you're not just quality, you're at the end of the line on a finishing line. I mean, you're quality control, right? So,
think about that for a second. So you talk about getting the job done, and yeah, that is what it's about, but it's more than getting the job done, right? So people go to work and they get frustrated. We all have frustrations. Even if our job is the greatest job in the world, we still have frustrations with our job. Mm-hmm. And so you're telling someone, listen, I will take on this frustration with you. And hopefully by the end of it, you're not as frustrated. And why do we not want people to be frustrated? Because we want them to have good lives. We want them to go home and not be upset about their day every day. Or
right.
We want them to go home and say, you know, today was a tough day, but so-and-so tried to help, or so-and-so helped, or, hey, it would have been worse if we wouldn't have had this team member helping me.
Right. Sort of like looking at the glass half full than half empty, right? You know, like, you know, yeah, I like that. I think for us, it's like, lately, I don't know what's gone on lately, but we do have another powder coater, a couple of them here on the island. And, you know, whatever is going on over there, you know, it doesn't matter to me. We're doing us, right? We've got our brand and who we are. We're very established. But you know, I'll get the customer coming into the door and he wants his rims done or whatever. And he's like, well, you know, I know the other guy. I'm personal friends with him. You know, so they kind of start off with that and I'm like, okay, I know it. But, you know, I think for me, at least when they're in this office and they want to get rims done or they're talking to Ross, we're non-judgmental, right? You know, we're not going to judge you because you're friends with that other guy. You're like, oh, you know that other guy. I'm not going to do that work for you, or I'm not going to give you a good deal, or, you know, you just have, you cop an attitude, I guess, you know, mm-hmm. You don't have to get that way. I mean, for me, it's just like, I just want you to powder coat your rims because I know it's a better finish, right? You know, like,
right.
My objectives are very simple. It's not just about bringing in more money or whatever. It's just like, look, get it done right, you know? And, you know, however you come to me, you know, but I always feel like I feel bad for those guys because they seem to have to apologize before they even step through the door, you know, like, well, you know, I'm friends with the other guy and, you know, I'm still going to be friends with him. And I'm like, I'm okay with that. You know, like, yeah. I'm not trying to change your relationship status. Okay.
Right.
The powder coater. Right. But, you know, at the same time, I'm like, well, I'm very happy that you have come to us because we are the authority and, you know, you're going to have to pay our prices. I don't know what he's charging over there, but, you know, this is what we do and this is how we're going to do it. Right. You know,
yeah.
Before I forget, I'm going to bring up the book because you showed us earlier what's on your desk, but I did bring up the website and the book. It's bluecollarleaders.com. And if you go to the store, you can buy this book for $17.99, looks like PayPal. I'm kind of intrigued. I'd like to read more about this. There are other books too that you can get into. But I think, you know, you don't need to... you know,
I always say that this book right here, this one specifically, this is the first one that I started to read. And this is the one that I actually handed out to a few people myself, because it gives you, it's like a roadmap.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, it's just, you know, I think you can, I'm just intrigued by what are all the traits and stuff like that. But like, I imagine, you know, it's not that if you're a reader of this book, you don't have any of these traits and you need to get them. I'm sure you do. A lot of it will be relatable. But there could be some traits out there that you haven't really considered, or maybe make the connections. Like, I think towards the end of that first chapter that you read, he was making this, you know, I guess kind of concluding to a greater understanding of how the importance of trust is in not just working with others, but relationship building. I mean, if you could, let's just face it, if there wasn't trust in the space program in the 60s, you know, we wouldn't have gone to the moon, right? Kind of thing. Like, we wouldn't have been building rockets. You have to have it seemed like if you could embrace the whole trust concept, you could do and be anything, really. I mean, I was just thinking of rockets while you were talking and reading that chapter. Like, that's how we got to the moon, right? We all had a team of highly trustable people to build this rocket or whatever, right? So,
yeah. And so, and you're right. And, you know, be trustworthy is like chapter two, but then there's also things like be humble, be responsible, be positive, be flexible. I'll skip a few here. I don't mean to, but be driven, be proud, be brave, be open-minded, be present, be observant, be helpful. Be helpful. I like that one. Be motivationable.
I think helpful is directly related to trustworthiness, helpfulness too. I think that's one of the concepts we have here is just help.
Yeah. And you know, you read the trust and every chapter after that reinforces that trust. And right. So it's showing you how to gain trust with people. And so, but there's a caveat to it though. There's a caveat to it.
Yeah.
You actually have to mean it. Like you have to mean it. Like if you don't mean it, people know, you know, it's like, oh, you know, that's what we call being authentic. Right. So if you're authentic, and, you know, we all do our best to be as authentic as we can be. And, you know, we all have stuff that we don't like to talk about. Lord knows. I mean, I did at the time. I'm pretty transparent now, but, you know, there's all of these things. And so, you know, it really does. It goes into these different traits and how you can achieve these things and doing it with authenticity because, you know, people can smell bull.
That's true.
They can. I mean, most people live their lives and they're like, oh, this guy's bulling me or this guy's not really feeling what he's saying or, you know, this or that. And, you know, I would sure hope that nobody felt that way about me because, you know, I'm a pretty open book. And you're going to find that out. You already know, but they're going to find out too.
Yeah. And what do you think of, like, I mean, do you work with a lot of, I mean, I'm going to hopefully get on the show here in connection with a guy who specifically talks about Gen Z workers, right? Can we just touch on that for a minute? And then I want to dive into maybe some more of our personal stories because there is, I'll share my story first and then I want you to join in with yours, but
you want to talk about Gen Z?
I don't want to bash Gen Z, but
no, you want to talk about Gen Z? I'll tell you the first thing that I think of when I think of Gen Z. Conscientious. So a lot of people have
that was not the word I was thinking. But
well, I think people tell me that a lot, though, and we have a lot of young people that work at Demco. I've worked with a lot of young people. I've been around a lot of young people in my time. I've helped at church with young people. So, when we talk about Gen Z and I have kids, you know, so, I think when people say, well, we can't find any good help and we can't, these young people, they just don't, I'm going to do what I always do. And I'm going to give you the really, because I don't see that. I just simply do not see it. People talk about, they don't want to work 50, 60 hours a week. They don't want to do this. They don't want to put in the time. Yes, they do. They want a reason to do it. They want to have someone to trust. They don't want to have to come to work and feel like they're going to get told what to do. That person's going to walk away from them, and then they're going to be lost. Because a lot of times, you know, your younger people, they've had maybe some different goals in their life, maybe.
And priorities.
They find themselves in a position where they come into either powder coating industry or they come into manufacturing and they're like, well, why am I here? Mm-hmm. And it's our job to show them how beneficial that is for them and how much room for growth there is in these companies, because there's not a lot of people out there right now. Like you were just saying, right? They different priorities. You don't see people getting in working with their hands and doing that a lot these days, but you do get that. And so you have that gap. You have the older generation leaving. And we talked about this at PCI, right? Where you have, you feel like all the knowledge is leaving. Well, the knowledge isn't leaving as long as you don't leave it there.
Well, so, that's what I'm trying to shout at these guys over at PCI, because the next one just retired, you know, Gima, Chris Merritt's been there for 40 something years. Now he's moving on, I think, hopefully to something that's going to be more in training. We'll wait and see. But, you know, that was part of the Custom Coder forum that we were part of. And I think that that one question, I don't remember the questions because it's like the last day of the show, and it's sort of a roundtable discussion, right? Yeah. Where we talk about, they actually had some really good questions, I thought. And one of them was around attracting employees and kind of covering Gen Z workers and stuff, and the dissemination of information. And one guy, you had a lot to say on that topic, of course. But one guy also added another table, said something about, well, they don't need to be, I want to say they didn't need to be, they're rock stars in their own world, I guess, because of social media. Right. Mm-hmm. I think that's what his point was that, well, when you have a million views on TikTok or you have X number of followers or whatever, they don't need that validation at work. They get it online. Right. You know, and I thought that's so sad. Right. That's so sad about society if it's come to that. Right. And I'd like to think more of Gen Z than that. But it was certainly a different point of view. I agree with it just yet or whatever, but I found it shocking.
I think it's sad if you think that way, to be honest with you.
Because that's what I thought. Yeah. Like what's happening?
I've never had that,
you know,
never had that experience in my entire life with anybody that was younger than me or that I've had to deal with. Gen Z is a generation of learners. They want to learn. They want to be told things. They want to know the reason behind it. Why do we do it? When I say that they don't like to be told, do this because I said so, it's because they want to know the reason behind what they're doing. And so I've never been in a situation where somebody was like, just tell me what to do and leave me alone. It's more of, there's a lot of questions that are asked. And sometimes the questions are asked with their body language, right? So if you're reading someone and you're looking at them and they're not saying a whole lot, then it's our job to ask those questions, right? It's our job to kind of get them to feel comfortable. And so we have a program at Demco and many other people have it. It's TWI, it's Training Within Industry. And so it talks about like job instruction and job relations. Well, the Max story, right? That's job relations all day, every day. That's job relations. It's how to relate to one another. It's how to talk to one another. And it's how to get things done when it feels like it's not possible, you know, and how do you do that? And so when we train people, we want them to feel comfortable, because if they feel comfortable, they'll be confident. And so with that confidence, you know, comes questions and comes ideas. And Gen Z has a lot of ideas. They may not know everything when it comes to manufacturing. I know I didn't when I came into manufacturing at 39, 40 years old. I had no clue about anything in manufacturing. And so I asked a lot of questions. And so you could kind of say, I mean, I'm not Gen Z, I'm Gen X, but it don't really matter to me because I ask a lot of questions anyway. And so I see that in Gen Z. They ask a lot of questions and they want to know the reason behind why I'm doing something. And I guess
I'd have to agree with you on that for sure. People, I think this generation is getting its head around this kind of trade school, trade work, and, you know, realizing that this is, you know, maybe a turn for the better in terms of manufacturers and, you know, manufacturing goods and services and stuff like that. So anyways, I just wanted to kind of, it's kind of timely that we're talking about Gen Z and, you know, just relationships at work, right? Trustworthy, building trustworthy relationships at work. When we're all just talking, you know, this is all just really what people are talking about right at the moment, you know?
Well, so, another thing too, another thing is that, you know, you do have a lot of that in trade schools. Really, they're kind of a saving grace because, you know, I think that there's kind of like a bad vibe out there about, you know, for a while it was like, go to college, don't go to trade school. You want to be a doctor or a lawyer as opposed to this or that. But I know so many people that have made an amazing living in the trades. And, you know, there's so much opportunity to work your way through, up, around, in. If, you know, you're in one trade and you get into that trade and you find yourself, I really like this aspect of it, then you can really get into those aspects of those trades that you like. So it's not like you're dead ended. And if you are dead ended, Demco's got openings. So, and other companies that do this stuff, they've got openings, you know, if you're dead ended in your job. And so there's plenty of opportunities out there for people. And there are many companies out there that are adopting this style, this culture style, because it is about culture and it's about, it's kind of, I talked to you one time about, I don't want this to sound bad, but you get down in the mud, right? So you have your older generation, like myself and yourself. I mean, we're not old, but we are compared to Gen Z. And so, you know, what's our job at that point? Well, our job is teaching and training the next generation, right? So, you know, I guess I take a lot of pride in teaching and training the next generation, even though some days I feel like I'm failing miserably, right? Because nothing goes your way, or you didn't get to the person that you wanted to get to, and you really wanted to spend time with that person, or, you know, life happens and things like that. But really, it's about trying to go out there and develop that culture and develop that trust and to show the younger generation or anybody that comes in the door, like, there are opportunities here, this place, that place. I mean, the opportunities that you have in your life, they're on you. They're up to you.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, you say that they ask a lot of questions, right? When you're training them or they're starting new at Demco. But I think it's because there's such a lack of trade schools. So trade schools are just introductory schools to kind of get you, you know, get your head around working with certain kinds of tools or how manufacturing works, you know, how service works, how all of this works. And so maybe it's, you know, when they're asking a million questions, people can get frustrated, right? Because, like, how do you not know how to use a drill? How do you not know how to use a hammer or this or that? You know, like, how do you not know what this tool is or what this thing is, or, you know, let alone having to teach them how to do the actual machine that they're working on, right? Kind of thing, right? So I can see where we kind of have been in this place where people that are working large corporations like yours that don't have a system like this in place, right? With this whole culture thing, is, you know, it can be frustrating because you're like, you're giving me this person that knows like nothing, and then I have to train them on this big machine safely, right? And stuff like that. So, you know, go ahead.
Let's talk about that for a second. So let's go back to that. And we talk about, you know, numerous studies have revealed our character is responsible for 87 to 90% of our ability to build trust. And that's not just your character. That's how you move through a company. That's your development. You know, so everybody is so focused on, you know, and as we should be for a part of it, is so focused on how do I use this tool? How do I do this? And how do I do that? As opposed to how do I develop my character to a point where I have the ability to learn all of these things that I want to learn? And how do I ask the questions that I need to ask if they're not given to me? And right. So, yeah, I mean, and the other coin on that is even when you go to college, and I won't put down colleges, my kids have been there, but, you know, it's, we get kids out of college and they don't know, and they go to school for engineering, but they know nothing about geometric dimensioning and tolerancing. So GD&T, they didn't learn that in college. And that's something that we use every single day when it comes to, is the part a quality part? Did it meet certain specs? Did it do this? So even though they go to college, right, you're having to teach them anyway. So mm-hmm. if they're going to a trade school and they're actually getting taught, if we can get trade schools to the point where people are wanting to go and to do those types of things, then they're really actually learning it before they get in the door. And so we see that a lot. And you know, colleges teach good stuff. But a lot of times in manufacturing, we're not finding that they're teaching things that are super practical to what we do. They're job specific. And so they have to be taught once they get in the door, whether they go to college or they don't.
Right, right. Well, you know, let's backtrack a little bit, go back to the trust topic, because you and I are into this personal transformation stuff. But at times I felt like there was something missing about me that kept me from succeeding. And I know that's going to sound really strange to a lot of the listeners of the show that this is actually coming out of my mouth right now, because people do look at me as an influencer. I don't recognize that, but I have to start now recognizing that. But, you know, it hasn't always been, it's been difficult. And part of it is that in the last year and a half, 2 years, I've had to deal with, you know, I've always had this, like, what's missing? What am I not getting? You know, I pride myself on knowledge and using my mind, applying myself at work or trying to break through a lot of things or learn new things. Like you know, you're a lifelong learner. You know, you can just tell by the way you're talking that's who you are. Mm-hmm. But your story hasn't always been an easy one. And talking about trust, it's easy for me to trust, to imbibe, I guess that's the word I'm looking for, to imbibe trust with my customers and my vendors, because that's who I am on the outside. But on the inside, or maybe the darker side of trust, is when I've experienced, you know, some trauma, childhood trauma, I have a hard time trusting others. Mm-hmm. And I'd like you to kind of maybe share a little bit about your story, because you know, you've gone through some tough times too. I'm not sure if they were in your childhood or when they were, but you know, and you haven't always been like this, Tanner.
Right? No. It's difficult because, you know, you talk about stuff and we talk about transparency. And I think even for somebody like myself, transparency is very difficult at times, because we do have to talk about things sometimes that we don't necessarily want to talk about. And I think people have this idea that I like talking about it, but I simply do not. I there's not a part of it that I like. Why do I talk about it? And why am I about to talk about something that I hate to talk about? Because there are so many people out there that are struggling to figure things out because of things that have happened to them in their past. So I will dig into it without dragging anybody through the mud. How does that sound?
Sounds good.
Right. So, when I was probably, I don't know, 13 years old, I was removed from the many different homes that I had to live in. The main home that I was living in was not a good situation. And I will leave that situation at that. But then I went into foster care. I went into detention centers because I didn't have any place to go. I went into boys' homes. I went into boys and girls' homes. I moved around a lot. And I had a lot of people that were supposed to be taking care of me that just simply either refused to or were too caught up in their own lives to care. Mm-hmm. And so it's a difficult thing. And it's hard for me to look up and talk about it because it's almost like, you know, you have that shame associated with it, even though there's no reason to feel shame over it. Right.
Right.
But you go into those situations, into those detention centers, and you are literally a number. And there's people that work there and they don't, a lot of times when I was younger, it just seemed like they didn't want to be there. And so they didn't really care. And you know, I grew up my whole life fighting, sleeping with one eye open is difficult because it's like, at least, you know, like when you were in a setting, like a detention center, like sleeping with one eye open, at least you, could understand that an attack is probably going to come. So, and it's from somebody that doesn't care about me. So, I'm going to be ready for that. So you grow up, you grow up, right? As
fight or flight, right? Yeah.
Yeah. You grow up as a young adult, right? And so you're fighting all the time or you're running all the time. Well, I was a fighter. And so, I was fighting a lot. And so then you kind of start to embody that a little bit. Mm-hmm. So you escape from monsters. And then if you're not careful, you become one. And so you have to be really careful with that. And so when I was 17 years old, I was emancipated as an adult. And in the state of Iowa, you could be considered an adult and because I just didn't simply have a place to go. And so at 17 years old, I was living out of my car and under bridges and different things of that nature. Now, I've lived on the streets before because those detention centers were terrible. And so I'd ran away from them a few times. And so I've had to learn how to kind of live without anything. So, but yeah, at 17, I was emancipated as an adult. And so I was living in my car and then something happened with that. And I was living under bridges and I didn't have any place to go. And so you live your life thinking that you are one way because you're a product of your environment. Mm-hmm. Right. And so you live that and then you carry that into adulthood. I mean, I met my wife when we were really young. I was 18 years old and she was just barely 16 when we, like actually 2 days before her 16th birthday, we started dating and we've been together ever since. But it was then it's like, how do I be a husband? And then she got pregnant and it was like, okay, how do I be a dad? And so you're kind of stumbling through life at that point. You think you got it right. And then one day you wake up and you're like, man, my life could be so much better than this. It's not that it's a bad life. It's just, you know, that there's better things out there because like you said, right. There's something missing. And so you have that in your life. And I'm not saying that this book in particular, is the thing that brought that to me, but it's the catalyst that brought that. So you start and you develop these traits and you go through and you start to do personal work and you find that maybe you need a little bit more work and maybe you need somebody else to talk to, you know, and, you know, May is Mental Health Month, right? And so you have a lot of, things that you work on and some people need to dig a little deeper and some people have more hurts and more things like that. But I think you see that a lot. I think that you definitely see it more if you lived that life, you understand it a little bit.
Well, I mean, for you, it's been, you know, how do you get back to trust, right? Because you were in a non-trusting environment. But for me, it's like, I guess the missing piece is trust because I don't really remember too many details because it happened to me when I was so little, you know, that I just, I guess that missing piece has been trust. Even though I can imbibe it and give trust to people, is sort of an imbalanced equation, because I don't really trust people, and then I have these business meetings, and I'm doing contract work and stuff like that, and I have to understand that I have to trust these people. Whether I have a contract with them or not, I have to. And even last night, I was in a meeting. It was late at night. And all that I wanted, when I kept having that feeling come up, I just said, you need to trust them. You need to trust them. That's kind of my mantra now, because I think the reason why I have been not achieving the success level that I am expecting for myself, this is not what people think of me. This is just my own personal, have I achieved what I want to personally be successful when that, sings to my core, right? I feel like it's the trust that blocks me from, because I'm not trusting that person. So I don't really want to work with them, or I don't want to pursue something that, I can't trust them with. And I don't know how to explain it. It's really weird. It's just this block, this feeling.
Difficult, right?
Yeah,
it's difficult.
It's difficult.
I used to have a saying. Yeah, I used to have a saying, right? I trust you to be who you are. And that's not really saying a lot, is it? Because it's like saying, well, if you're a really crappy person, I trust that you're going to be a crappy person.
Well, you could lie. You could lie too, right? How many times have we been in the front of liars, where they can just talk up a storm and lie, and you believe every bit of it, right? So it's hard to.
Well, I'm a little different though. I grew up not trusting people. You talk about that, and I never trusted anybody around me. So you develop this sense, you can feel the energy in a room. I know that sounds weird, but
no, I think what you're describing is something that's external in terms of trusting people. And what I'm describing is something internal that affects me, but they're both related to trauma, right? I may not understand all of the stuff that happened to me because I don't have the memories for them. I was too young, whatever, to have developed. I have some memories of it, but I don't have the whole picture. I just know that inside I don't feel full or 100%, right? It's good to talk. This is the first time that I've shared this on the show. And it was funny because until I met you, I would never bring about. You bring that out of me, Tanner, but go ahead.
Yeah, no. Some people say that I have that effect on people. And I think it's just really, it's being empathetic. I mean, I can really empathize where a lot of people come from, it's kind of like, I can see that, and you see things a little bit differently. And when you're talking about trust, I think the most important thing, for trust that you can have, what helps develop trust in others is trust in yourself.
Right. And so start there.
Yeah. You have to trust yourself. You have to trust in certain situations that you're going to act or react a certain way, or you're going to handle it a certain way. And so that really helps when it comes to situational things. And so when you talk internally, it's about trusting yourself. And, for me, it's about trusting in God. And so I don't have to worry about do I trust this person or don't I trust this person, because I trust me and I trust God. So I trust what they're telling me at face value, because that's what we deal with people most of the time. We deal with them at face value. And then if we get the opportunity, we dig a little deeper if they allow us to.
Right.
And so then that's when trust between people is developed. And so it's by sharing a little bit, it's by talking to people, it's by finding out, and not just doing a job, but it's finding out who they are as people and what they like and what they don't like. And so-and-so likes to go fishing this week, and hey, I'm going to go fishing, and hey, do you want to come fishing with me? And, even if they don't, it's kind of like, hey, I'm extending this this olive branch to you. And, you know, if you want to, you can, but no pressure type of deal, you know, and it's just about people. Right. It's just about people.
Yeah. And you realize that that's, you know, a lot of times when people, you get a reaction from someone or an unexpected reaction, even, you know, it probably is based on that, you know, on trust, you know, and for whatever reason, they're the way they grew up or the background that they have, like you just described your own. And, you know, I think for me, you know, I did a show with a life coach and I loved him. I think it was episode 40, I want to say 46 or 47, where he actually, you know, we talked about Elon Musk and how he just attracts all these top talent people to do, to get things approached, you know, you just blazing a trail to space kind of thing and how he gets it done. But, you know, he really wanted me to be part of his, you know, program. And I was all for it. But I stopped because I realized that the problem that I was suffering from had nothing to do with the steps it was going to take to get to the goal that I needed to do. Right. So I am a high performing person and I can get things checked off the list and goals accomplished. I don't know. I could probably do better with organization, but for the most part, it was this missing piece that I knew he couldn't solve for me. And so I ended up looking up seeing a psychologist who deals specifically with trauma, emotional trauma, whether you can identify it or not. I was just so blessed that the person, one of the best people I think I've ever met in trauma, because I've had other I've done psychology route before when I was younger and had young kids and I'm this stressed out mom. This person that I dealt with actually here on the island, she is just an angel because she is so good at what she does. She actually is a trauma specialist and I just fell right into her. Things connected so easily. And, you know, I worked with her for a short amount of time. I could have probably stayed a little longer with her, but it kind of got me through a very difficult time because I felt like if I couldn't, you know, get to this or acknowledge the trauma, that was, you know, my thing. It was, what good is going to a life coach and paying a few thousand dollars to get you organized or get you accomplished when the problem is still there, right? It's this core problem. I'm so glad that we're talking about trust and trustworthiness and how to build character through trust, because it really has, it really is a core block, cornerstone to building character.
It is. It's the block, right? I mean,
right,
so
the block.
When you talk about, you know, you talk about trauma and so I think in industry and I don't know how many people there are, but I mean, for myself, I have a form of PTSD and it's complex post-traumatic stress disorder. And so that's difficult on a daily basis. You know, you wake up with it and some days you fight it a little bit. Some days it's not so bad and some days it's really bad. And so it's good to find people that you do trust, that you can work through some of that stuff with. And there are different therapies out there like EMDR therapy. Yep. And you know, it's just a response therapy, but it works really well with people with PTSD. Mm-hmm. And so there are some other things out there that I don't personally endorse, but you know, there's like immersion therapy and there's different things. I don't endorse any of that, but EMDR, I definitely endorse that. It's just how your brain processes certain things. And so like, when you get into like a fight or a flight response, you know, you're going to do one of two things. If you have trauma, you're going to fight or you're going to run. And it looks different, you know, disassociating, different things like that. I won't get too far into it. It's pretty in-depth conversation, but, there's a lot of different things that you can do. But EMDR is just something that you don't have there. You have these little tools that you can use mm-hmm. and stuff like that. But it's not something that you need to have. It's just something that you can learn. And it's a way for your brain to process certain things because you misprocess things. Because once you get into that mode, like people talk a lot about, and I hate to use this as a reference, but it's almost like an adrenaline response. Like if you're a mom, you're a mom. And, you know, they say that mothers can have like amazing strength, right? If their child's in danger or something like that. But it's kind of like your brain shuts off when you get that adrenaline that goes. And so before you get to that point where your brain kind of shuts off and you get into your fight or your flight, you go through, you know, this back and forth in your head. And it's not a back and forth in your brain. It's just kind of you know, you're like tapping one side, then the other, or you have a paddle or whatever you have as far as the EMDR goes. But that's a really good therapy.
It is
for me really well.
That's how I ended up finding my trauma specialist too. And, you know, I think that, you know, because the counter to that, if you don't learn these EMDR things and build character, is that you'll constantly be in a state of anxiety and reactiveness and rather than responsiveness. And I think that for me, my typical is, because of the non-trusting issue, is that I think people are out to get me. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to be taken advantage of. Right. These are just some of the thoughts that I go through. Rather than just allowing the person to interact with me, and seeing what happens, you know, I have a friend of mine, a girlfriend that I find very well accomplished in my mind, right? A mentor of sorts, but really just a really good friend. And I was just always amazed at how she allowed herself to be part of the chaos, I guess. If an owner was, you know, in her business, she worked with contracts and ownership. So she had a vacation rental company. And so many times these owners, you know, they'll promise the world, I'm going to fix up my place and everything. And then she'd just sign the contract. You know, obviously she needs to build her company up and bring income in. But, you know, so many times they would just let her down, right? You know, they wouldn't replace the carpet or do this, and then they'd get a complaint. And I'm like, why are you allowing yourself to be taken advantage of, right? You know, I always felt like that was a weakness. But in a sense, it was kind of just her way of, you know, embracing the relationship, right? Because relationships can be up and down. They're not perfect. Like getting back to what you were saying, you know, you, some days are tough. You can't answer the question, or you can't help the person at the level that you want to help them at. And can you just be okay with the fact that it's not perfect, right? I think that's tough, is a right? hard one for me. Very, very hard, because I'm so cerebral. Now I'm getting kind of emotional now talking about that, right? Is can you be okay with imperfectness? Because you're trying to outwardly kind of control everything. You can't.
Yeah. And so we go back to that control thing, right? And that's why I talk about control, because you really only in control of three things.
Yeah.
You know, your thoughts, your emotions, and your actions. And you can't control the situations around you. You can't control other people. And, you know, the sooner that we learn that, I think the better that is. I mean, we always get to, no matter what, we get to set boundaries as human beings. And we can say, nope, you can't pass this boundary, or you can just simply not involve yourself in something if it's a boundary of yours, right? So that's important too. You know what your boundaries are as a human being, because especially if you have trauma in your life, or you're similar to me, I try my hardest to give everything I can to every situation. And so when you do that, you have a tendency to burn yourself out. And so you have to be careful with that too. So you have mm-hmm. to set like solid boundaries in your life, and then understand that not every situation is controllable. The only thing that you can control in the situation is your response to it, right? Like Mac talks about, there's a pause. And so between And I'm going to murder this because I always do. And he's going to laugh at me one of these days for murdering it as bad as I do. But it's kind of like there's between the stimulus and response, there's a pause. And so you're going to get stimulated at one point in time, whether it's good or bad. And so the thing to keep in mind is no matter what that is, pause first. Make sure that you get yourself under you. And this is people without trauma too. This is everybody. It's, you know, let's just take a pause. You don't have to speak right away. Just pause, take in what they're saying, try to absorb that on a level before you respond to it, because you'll find that if you do that and you listen with the intent to understand someone and not with the intent to respond, then your response is usually a poignant response or it's on the mark, right? Like, okay, your response is good. And then you don't have to worry about upsetting somebody because you thought about what you were going to say before you say it. It seems so simple, right? But so few people do it. I'm the worst at it. When you talk, I want to talk too. You know, I want to have this back and forth, but I have to remind myself all the time, just absorb what she's saying and then respond to that. And I think that that's where our power comes, right?
Isn't that
pause? Your power comes in your pause.
And I'm going to pause here because this is part of the reason why I am doing the podcast is for my own ability to sort of train myself to pause, to not jump in on somebody. And I know I've done it a few times and, you know, I get excited because I have something to say too. I want to contribute to the conversation. But yes, having this podcast has taught me to be more pausey. and I do think there is a deep connection between pause and allowing that, whatever that person just said, to kind of resonate with you and your own. And I'm going to bring up my girlfriend again, because I had a conversation with her a few months ago about these contracts that we're getting into, and they're very anxiety driven for me. And she's like, well, how does it, you know, like we talked about the gut, right? And the gut response, right? That intuitive, how do you feel about the person? Well, this is hard for me because I have this trauma and I don't trust people. And so I don't learn to train my gut reaction or I don't allow the pause, because I think the pause and the gut reaction are related. I'm not sure how yet, but they are. And so, I don't know what else to say to that, but I know that they're related.
You know, what's funny though, is that pause sometimes, especially for me, sometimes the pause is 24 hours. It's 48 hours. Sometimes there's a pause to the point where I don't have a response for you right now. I wish I, you know, or maybe your response is wrong and then you take a pause and then you go back. But when you listen with the intent to understand people, when you really pay attention to their words and what they're saying, they can see that in you. They can see that you're paying attention to them. And, you know, it's all these little things, right? Like, you know, my kid is in this program called CAPS that they have for school, and it teaches leadership and it teaches leadership development, and they help businesses. And it's a really cool program. But, you know, they do a lot with communication. So communication is the key to how we survive as human beings. Mm-hmm. And if we're bad communicators, which I am sometimes, if we're bad communicators, then we get frustrated because we feel like we don't get our point across. And that's how other people feel when they speak to us. And if we don't take a pause and we don't listen to their words and we're not paying attention to what they're saying, then we're going to miss it. And they're going to know that we miss it.
Right. Yeah. I've learned a lot on pause in contract because, you don't have to, if somebody sends you an email, unhappy customer, or, you know, a question about something or a job, and you're like, okay, I don't have to respond to this right at the moment. And it's not just because you have a million other things or your phone is exploding or something, the phone's ringing off the hook or whatever. It's not, it goes beyond that. It's just so you can kind of have this pause to really check with the gut on what your best response is. And I have learned in the last, I would say in the last two years, how to embrace the pause, you know, even though I don't, it's not natural for me to embrace the pause, you know, however long it is, whether it's 5 seconds or 24 hours. Yeah.
And yeah. And it's like, so it's funny that you bring that up because, you know, you email me and it takes me 2 days to get back to you with a response, because I think people think that, oh yeah, like he likes doing this. I'm not particularly like look at me type of a person. Like, let me go on this podcast and have people look at me and pay attention to my words and the things that I'm saying. I would rather not. And I was talking about this a little bit today with somebody else before this. And it's kind of like, this goes against who I am inside. Like, I don't want to be this outward person, right?
Right.
But you almost feel like you're obligated to do it because of the things that you've learned.
You were really obligated to do it because I forgot to hit record on our last. So we're back at it again.
Yeah. And I thought about that a little bit and I was like, man, I really don't like doing things twice, but you need to pause here before you respond because you don't want to respond the wrong way. And so,
sorry to get you off track, but I had to bring in that comic relief there. But, you know, like, yeah, it was like, oh, I felt terrible, right? You know, like, I actually paused before I sent that email to you because I felt horrible for that. And that hardly ever happens to me. I think I've done it once or twice, but that's about it. And nobody wants to come back and say, can you record again? You know, but this has actually been, and I loved your response because your response was, well, it'll certainly be better next time. Right.
Yeah.
Instead of saying, wasting my time or whatever. Right. You know?
Well, initially, because it was at 10:48 my time when you sent that email. And so I just happened to be up. I don't sleep well. So I just happened to be up and I looked at it and I was like, no, you know, I was like, I cannot believe that just happened. And so my response came later because it was like, I got to get in the right headspace here.
You know? I sent it to you late because I was thinking you're going to see it in the morning and you'll be rested, right?
Yeah, well, not so much, but I didn't wait to respond to it until I was rested. So it was just one of those things where, you know, and we get back to that. So you have this feeling, right? You know, and it's like, oh my gosh, like I can't, but it's not really a feeling towards that person. And it's the situation itself and it's a feeling. It's not how you actually feel about it. So you really have to sit with it a little bit, you know, and you're just like, okay, how do I really feel about this? Okay. I'm frustrated because I thought the first time was really good, but maybe the second time, maybe it won't be as good, but who cares? Right. Like, we're just going to do it anyway because it needs to be done.
It needs to be. Yeah. Our podcast needed to be said. For sure, because I think what you have to contribute, whether you are an introvert at heart, but I think you do have a very good voice. We are talking about the voice of custom coding. You are in the industry and you have a story to share. You have a personal story to share and you have your own company success to share and how you're part of that success every day. And you're not the only one there doing this program, you know, acting on these principles, really. It's really just principles, you know. And I'm always about, I try to be about balance or in my own life, I realize that I'm imbalanced in certain ways. So, you know, it's kind of been this thing, this new thing for me is to try to get back to the balance because I have so many things I want to do. Like I have this podcast and then I have the day-to-day stuff here at the desk and I have other websites that I want to, you know, and gaps that we want to fill in this industry and I want to help people. Like I want to be helpful, right? So it tends to kind of get a little too much sometimes, you know, when it's all at me. But it's nice to take a break with you today, Tanner, because I feel like I'm taking a break now from the chaos, right? And stuff, even though I created a little bit of chaos with forgetting to hit the record button. But thank you so much.
No, and that's all right.
On, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's no problem. And I get that. I get the fact that you have all these things that you want to do. And, you know, I have that too, you know, I've been asked before, what do you want to do? And I can't answer that question. Most of the time I've been afforded different opportunities that I'm not necessarily have passed up, but that I've kind of slow played. And because, you know, you get into a certain thing when you get into the character development, I always thought I wanted to go in one direction, you know, and I thought, okay, direction, I'm a product guy. I'm not an engineer, but I got like that kind of a mindset where I like to know how things work and why things go wrong and how can we problem solve it. And so very analytical, right? And you get into that and so you're one tracked and then you start doing this, what I call character development. And so you start doing that and then you find yourself having a love for people in general. Then you find other avenues that you want to go down and things that you want to do. And so then you get more confused at times and you're like, well, I don't know what I want to do. I guess I'll just do what right. I'm doing right now and where let the cards fall where they may. Right. You know, it's right. just, it's one of those things and you don't want to feel like you're pulled in one direction or the other direction. You're just being as a person and you just do what you do every single day. And it doesn't really matter. Right. Like right. you could be in custom coding or you could be in quality or you could be new in the door and you just got to find out what your love and your passion is and do that, you know, and you can find that in industry. And that's the greatest part about it.
Yeah. I think manufacturing is coming back. And I think for me, it's like, as a business owner, I feel like sometimes, you know, you're on this track, you're on this path, you've got these strategic goals, you're at it every day, you're chipping away. And then, you know, a natural disaster happens or, you know, COVID happens or pandemic or whatever, you know, and it's just like, I feel like sometimes I think that a lot of people in this world with the last few years that we've had, okay, it's teaching us flexibility, for sure. And how flexible we can be, even though we don't want to be, and, you know, it's everybody's, I've seen some pretty tragic things happen, to people I know. And I wish the best for them. And we can all relate. I think that it's just everything that happens on a global scale has just been so relatable, right? You know, sure. And so real and in your face, you know, and stuff, but I know we'll get on another tangent, Tanner. And I know we've got to kind of wrap this up because it's late where you are. It's Friday afternoon, and I know you want to get home to your family and stuff. So I want to thank you for coming on the show. And I'm going to pop up the book one more time because it is so important. It's you can find the book on Amazon, but also here at this author's page, which is called bluecollarleaders.com. And the book is called Blue Collar Leadership and Teamwork, 30 Traits of High Impact Players. I'm glad you shared that one chapter because it really kind of gives you an insight as to what the book is going to be for you. And I'm actually more intrigued to get it now and start reading about it, you know, because we've talked about some really important principles here.
Well, I believe in it enough to where, like I said, I've handed it out and stuff like that. And this blue collar site right here, I would really encourage that because you don't have to, I say it like this, you don't have to buy the book right away. If you don't want to go check out his stuff, he's got YouTube, he's got all kinds of different things that you can access from his site. His wife has got things out there too for everybody. So, you know, man, woman, doesn't matter. You know, there's content out there. And I would just really encourage people to dig into some content, even if it's you just nice and private doing it, dig into some content, see if the content is for you.
Resonates. You know, yeah.
I didn't think it was going to be for me, and it is. So, yeah. I mean, you know, if you don't think it's for you, give it a shot. You know, that's the only thing I can say.
And the author's name is Max Story. And apparently they go around the United States and do all kinds of presentations and stuff like that too. And we'll make sure to put the link for this book or the link to, you know, to this website in the description of the webinar, or not a webinar, it's a podcast, but we'll make sure it's in there so that you have it easy. If you want to go and check it out, we're not making any money on it or anything. It's just putting it out there, and we'll put a link to Demco in case anybody's looking for a job and stuff and wants to work with Tanner. I'd want to work with you, Tanner.
I'm glad. I can be a little, I'm like this all the time. So,
oh gosh.
It can be. Yeah. When I'm not super quiet, I'm like this. If people talk to me and we talk about content like this, this is pretty much how I'm going to react to it. So.
Yeah. Well, good. And it's so good to meet you again. You know, one of the fine people, you brought two other guys with you to Powder Coating Week. And this is just one of the guys that I met at Powder Coating Week. And it's just such a good way to meet people in the industry, and stuff like that, you know? So, I always come away with meeting new faces, and it's a great relationship there at Powder Coating Week. You never know who you're going to meet, right? And to mix around the tables, right? You know, because I didn't see you till the last day, and you'd been there for a couple of days. So anyways, yeah. Well, awesome. It's so good to meet. And I'm glad we did re-record this show because I think we made it even better than the last time. And it's so good to know you now.
All right. That's awesome. Well, it's good to know you too. And it's good to talk to you again. And I'm sure we'll talk again.
Awesome. Well, you have a beautiful weekend. Everybody that's listening, make sure to like, share, and subscribe to the podcast at rosscoat.com. You can also find us on our new Instagram, which I launched this week, at rosscoat, R-O-S-S-K-O-T-E. I was getting kind of a bit of a brand crossover thing happening with our job shop Instagram at Maui Powder Works, and then the podcast, you know, it just wasn't working. And I'm so glad that I made the split. Sometimes brands do need to kind of split off and do their own thing. And I'm so glad that I did, because I think it's worked out for the better, and it doesn't confuse the followers as much. So head on over to rosscoat.com on TikTok and YouTube and all that kind of stuff. So thanks for joining us today, and aloha.